Hello, this is Larry W. Robinson from GospelUpdates.com. You're listening to Apostle Designate John E. Ross on the Let's Talk to the Lord Gospel Radio Show. Stay tuned.
Why the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, thou should have no pleasure in thee. Jesus is gone and what you're here is soon to come. Christ on your side, you can make it. Christ on your side, you can make it. Christ on your side, you can make it. Christ on your side. Jesus is calling.
He's calling.
Jesus is calling. Even calling you.
Remember, he called from day one. Remember them times you had the stacks and the guns. Man. Remember them times where everything went wrong and you blamed everyone else with that same old song. It got old. You gotta call.
Holy greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am the Apostle Designate, Minister John E. Ross, lead minister and founder of the Omega International Prophetic Ministries, and you are listening to the 2018 Image Award-winning and Spin Award-winning Let's Talk to the Lord Gospel Radio Talk Show. And this is Season 3 of Let's Talk to the Lord Kingdom. Our guest for this episode is Apostle Moses Kwagals. Apostle Moses Kwagals, welcome to Let's Talk to the Lord.
Thank you very much, Apostle John Rose, for this invitation. Greetings to all of you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's me, Apostle Moses Kwagals, normally referred to as Apostle MMK, streaming live here in Kenya, East Africa. Bless you.
Amen. And to begin our dialogue for this episode, please tell the kingdom and listeners about the early riser's cry.
Thank you very much, Apostle. The early riser's cry is the word that we have acronymized. It's an acronym of the word Turk, which is the early riser's cry. The early riser's cry is an apostolic and prophetic non-denominational prayer global prayer network raised as God's tool of transformation and revival to bring hope and direction to those individuals, to those individuals and nations at the crossroads of their divine destinies.
Yes,
so
Lord.
Our purpose is raising foundations for future generations and a people of fire. Why? Because when we say a people of fire, what do we mean? On the 23rd of May, 2014, I was in my prayer, 40 days of fasting and prayer in Britain, where I was at the time pastoring and running my business. And the Lord, I had an encounter with the person of Jesus Christ, and he told me, raise me a generation of a people of fire. I continued to ask him what that meant. I didn't understand. Then he, on the 13th of June, I was running revivals in the city
Hallelujah.
Of Frankfurt. The city of Frankfurt in Germany. And then the Lord appeared again and told me what I told you on the 23rd of May, 2014, a generation of a people of fire, a people who are spirit conscious, God conscious, not needs conscious, but God's conscious.
Yes,
you see,
Lord.
There is a difference between love and lust. Lust seeks to satisfy itself at the expense of others, whereas love seeks to give to others at the expense of self. Now, there's loads of us who go to God and like a grocery store, we want things from him, but love seeks to give out at the expense of self. Well, as lust seeks to get. A lot of people have turned God into a grocery, but God loves relationship. Now, going back to the key scripture of the early riser's cry, it's taken, if you read the Amplified version, you will find out Psalms 119 and verse 147, the Bible says, I anticipated the dawning of the morning and I cried in childlike prayer. I hoped in your word. And the early risers cry, we need to understand that the foundation of the day, the morning is the foundation of the day. How you begin your day in God will determine how you finish your day. God does not overlook foundation. So the early risers cry is to awaken an army of intercessors, because for the end time move of God. I was a Muslim, and this has not just happened now. When I, in 1992, to cut the answer short, 1992, when I was contemplating suicide as a Muslim boy, when I had an encounter with the person of Jesus Christ, that was after the death of my mother. And I felt my world had broken apart. And I didn't need to live anymore. So I decided to commit suicide. And I say this statement, if there is a God in heaven, let him stop me from committing suicide. And that's when Jesus appeared. And I came out of this body. I had an encounter for 7 hours when I was out of this body. That's where my apostolic call came from, to the nations. And after 2 weeks of my conversions, then I had a vision when garments, like you see the American choir have those long garments when they are singing. So garments are dropping from heaven with two colors, white and blue. Sky blue and white, and a golden trumpet would appear. And that's when the Lord told me that he's raising me. When we walked with this group of people, there were apostles, prophets, teachers, and evangelists, we had fire on our heads, our hands, and our feet. And that's when the Lord told me, I have called you and chosen you into the apostolic and the prophet as an instrument for the reawakening of the nations around the world. So with that came persecution, of course, I became homeless. But that's the birthing of the early riser's cry. So you see, whoever, there's a saying in English that the early bird catches the early worm. In the kingdom of darkness, the sons of darkness understand the importance of the day. So at midnight, they take authority over the day. So all these scriptures that we see in the Bible talking about the morning. Jesus woke up before dawn and took authority over the day. Most of the people are unaware about elements and how the devil plans his kingdom and how he executes. I come from a family where my great-grandfather in Uganda, though I'm here in Kenya, in Uganda, he was the chief, let's say, the one who mentored and raised sorcerers, witches, warlocks. He was one of the flying warlocks. Flying. When I say flying, they never needed a plane, never needed to go into an aircraft. So, and he used to control all the things, speaking to the elements, to the trees, to the rivers, to the snakes, and all those kind of things. So he would astral project and come out of the body and go miles and come back. So I grew up in a family where the powers of darkness were on the extreme, those who exercised them. Now, coming to Christ, for me, it's not a mistake. I know the principles which are being practiced in the kingdom of darkness. I can cut it short, but I'll say to you, TAC is a non-denominational prayer global network. We have a prophetic and apostolic mandate of teaching, mentoring, and raising God, a fire generation, a generation of the God carriers. This network, it is our dream and passion to connect our globe in prayer by raising individuals in various cities and nations to take and embrace their intercessory and the priestly responsibility. For all believers in Christ have been called to the ministry or the responsibility of intercession. So it is our dream and passion to raise national altars through intentional and aggressive intercessory prayer. So we are committed, lastly, to seeing the birthing of individuals, nations, and destinies into reality through the power of fervent and agonizing prayer.
And Apostle, please tell the kingdom, what is the job of an intercessor?
What is the job of the intercessor? Thank you very much, sir. When we talk about intercession, we're going to talk about, first and foremost, the word intercession comes from an intercessor. I would say first and foremost is a watchman. Is a watchman. But the word intercession comes from a Latin, the Latin word intercedere. Intercedere is a Latin word from which we derive the word intercession. That word means to intercept. The Latin word intercedere means to intercept, to interrupt, to go in between, or to interfere. So the main job of an intercessor is to interrupt the powers of darkness, to intercept whatever the kingdom of God is trying to do. That's why the Bible says in Luke 18 and verse 18, whatsoever you shall forbid on earth shall be as having been already forbidden in heaven. So what you permit on earth shall be permitted in heaven. And that's when many people are telling them that whatever you tolerate, heaven will accommodate. So when we look at the atrocities going on in the world, and we start to look at God and ask God, why is this happening? It's just because we are ignorant of our responsive role, kingdom roles. An intercessor is an interceptor. He stands between. You stand and oppose the powers of darkness in order to get the destinies.
Apostle,
Apostle,
is there a difference, though, between a appointed intercessor or a person who is just has the call of the intercessor? What's the difference if you've been appointed?
Before, I used to think that there were people who are appointed to be intercessors. I used to have that notion that specifically there is somebody who was gifted as an intercessor. But the Bible, when you look at the New Testament and you read through it, you don't find specifically people that God says, I have called into the ministry specifically of intercession. Why? Because every believer in the New Testament has been called to the duty and responsibility of intercession. That's why the Bible says in 1 Peter, as we all know, 2:9, we are called royal priesthood. We are a royal priesthood. So every believer has been called to the ministry of a priesthood. So intercession is for everybody in the body of Jesus Christ. Before there is a mother, before there is a father, before you are a lawyer, before you are a teacher, a preacher, a singer, you are a prophet, apostle, you are initially an intercessor. An intercessor is the one who goes in between, the one who stands in between. So that's a role for every believer in Christ. But unfortunately, the devil has succeeded in lying to many that there are those who are specifically called into intercession, and there are those that are not, it's not their gift to intercede. Well, the question would be, is there any person that is not called to intercept the works of darkness? It is called for all of us. It's our role, all of us, preacher, non-preacher, to intercept, to interrupt whatever the devil's trying to do in the earth realm. Thank you, sir.
Amen. So we just need the Holy Spirit to give us instruction to which area that we need to begin to intercede in. Is that correct, Apostle?
Yes, exactly. The more we yield, the more we are. I would say there are several levels of intercession. There are specific assignments with intercession, and we grow into, there are also dimensions intercession. There is kindergarten, there is novice, there is a senior level of intercession. But you see, the junior level of intercession, as you begin, the Bible says, whoever is faithful in the least, God will entrust him with much. So as you begin to be faithful in the least, take for instance, the Holy Spirit may prompt you to pray for Brother John, to pray for Sister Penny, and whatever he has given to you. When you are faithful in that little, then he will take you. That is the level.
Hallelujah.
Of, you know, the junior level. When you are faithful in the junior level, then he will take you beyond that. He will give you a message to pray for the church. Then it begin to take you from the church to community to the nation. Then God will begin to talk to you on a global level. Then the more you are faithful, that's when he entrusts you with visions, prophetic dreams concerning our nations, concerning cities. But you have been faithful initially with the least, with the promptings. Have you ever sat somewhere praying and you're not thinking about anybody? And then a name drops into your spirit about someone in your church or somebody in your neighborhood, and that name you carry it in your spirit. And as you begin to pray, Before you know, when you go back to church, they tell you, oh, so-and-so was in such trouble at such and such a time. But that was the very time you took your responsibility, you were faithful, and you prayed, though you didn't understand, you prayed in the spirit, let her to know they were in trouble. So as you begin to be faithful in those little promptings of the Holy Spirit, he entrusts you with more responsibility of intercession.
Amen. Now, I want to take a few moments to get a little more in depth about the Early Risers Cry. Kingdom, the Facebook Live videos are available to listen and watch and pray along with Apostle Moses as he is leading us in prayer. They are posted on the group page, the Working on the Let's Talk to the Lord Gospel Radio Show group page. They're posted there. Please go there. I myself pray along and have been very blessed and educated from the prayer intercession and the teachings coming from Apostle Moses. However, during the broadcast, Apostle, I have heard you use the phrase, I have a blood boat right to pray and get answers to my prayer. What do you mean when you say you have a blood boat right?
Thank you, sir. You see, the blood of Jesus Christ, when we look at the scriptures, even in Romans chapter 8, and from the 15th verse, we see that the Bible says that God has not given us the spirit of fear to put us once more in bondage, but he has given us the spirit of sonship, you know, in which in the bliss we cry out, Abba, Father. But that blood, bought right, we look at also Revelation chapter 5 and verse 10. The Bible says, and he has purchased all men from all tribes and languages by the blood of Jesus, and he has made us into a kingdom of priests, kings and priests. So the blood has given us legal right to operate as kings and as kings and priests in the earth realm. So when I say I have a blood boat right, I have confidence. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 19, a lot of people think that it is by thanksgiving that we enter into the presence of the Lord, because they are referring to Psalms 100. But however, that's not the case. David was an Old Testament prophet, priest, and a king who understood the role of the priest. So when he say, I will enter your gates with thanksgiving, what was he referring to? We all understand in the tabernacle, you would not approach without the blood. Without blood, you could not enter. So that I enter your gates with thanksgiving, he was thanking what? It means he was entering by means of the blood together with
thanksgiving. Yes, Jesus.
He was entering by the blood together with them. He says, I come into your presence by the blood together with the thanksgiving. Being aware that without this blood, I would not have been able to make it before your presence. So it is the blood of an innocent animal that has given me access into this place. So I enter together with thanksgiving for the blood of the innocent. That's why for us, Hebrews 10:19 says, brothers, we have confidence to enter into the most holiest place, not by praise, not by worship, but by the blood of the Lamb of God. It gives us access. So it gives you that blood bought. You are bought by the blood, and that blood gave you the right to pray in order for you to pray and get answers. Because scripture says in Corinthians, all answers are yes and amen to all of us who are in Christ Jesus. But who has given me access? The blood of Jesus Christ gives you legal right to operate from the realm of the spirit and execute whatever is divine and implement it as a heaven's legislator here on earth. So you must...
But Apostle, we need to know about the boat. What is the symbolic meaning about the boat?
About the what? The boat. Boat, not a boat. It's boat. B-O-U. G-H-T, boat, you know, buying.
Yes.
It's not a boat as B-O-A-T. It is, I have a blood boat. I was bought by the blood, purchased. So I have a blood boat, right?
So we have a blood bought, right? We've been bought by the blood of Jesus.
Exactly, yes. We've been bought by the blood.
Amen. Apostle, what does it mean to drink of the blood of Jesus and eat of his body?
Thank you very much, sir. When we look at the scriptures in John chapter 6, the scripture speaks expressively. In John chapter 6, Jesus commanded when he gave to us communion. I would speak in two dimensions. Let me refer to the two kingdoms. In the kingdom of darkness, where I came from, where my great-grandfather were ministers of Satan, and who were even astro-projecting, flying witches and wizards, warlocks, name them. They understand in the kingdom of God the premise of the blood, the principle of the blood. First and foremost, I will start with the scripture in Leviticus chapter 17 and verse 11. The Bible says that the life of a creature is in its blood. The life of a creature is in its blood. If the life of a creature is in its blood, therefore the life of Jesus Christ is in his blood. So when Jesus shed his blood, he shed his life. So the blood of Jesus signifies the life of Jesus Christ. So this is the time, I believe, Apostle, to invite the Holy Spirit to open the eyes of the church to see and understand the hidden truth and the power loaded in the blood of Jesus Christ. Why? The understanding of this secret will establish the church of God as an unstoppable and unbeatable arm on earth. I don't have much time to go into that is deep, but let me try my best. The blood of Jesus Christ is one of the strongest weapons God Almighty has made available to the church in this end time battle. Why? Because the blood of Jesus is the only weapon. Is not only a weapon, but also is the flag. The blood of Jesus is a flag that flies over the territories that are owned by the Savior, Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ establishes an enforceable boundary. It establishes an enforceable boundary line that Satan has no choice but to respect. Today, Satan and his agents have counterfeited many weapons in the body of Jesus Christ. Let us consider the following weapons and the opposing satanic weapons that they have camouflaged and forged. The Holy Spirit versus false spirits. Truth versus lies. Prophets of God versus false prophets. Messiah versus Antichrist. God's angels versus fallen angels. It's only the blood of Jesus Christ that Satan has no counterfeit for, nor will he ever have one. As a matter of fact, Satan and his fallen angels have no blood and do not have any power and authority to produce any blood. That is why the blood of Jesus has no counter defense. Satan has no defense against the blood of Jesus. I want to conclude to answer this question straight by making this remark. The blood of Jesus is the kingdom nuclear bomb. Therefore, child of God who is listening to me, this is the time to bring a complete and permanent destruction to the kingdom of darkness by the power that is in the blood of Jesus Christ.
What does it mean to eat of his body?
To partake of his body is to come into union with him. The flesh of Jesus is Jesus Christ himself. His blood is his life. So when we are invited at the table of fellowship, we come to partake of his flesh, himself, Jesus Christ. It is at that point that we enter into union with him, complete union, spirit by spirit to spirit, union with Christ. It's not that you are having a piece of bread over there and it's just a representation. You must know that in the realm of the spirit, you are having real flesh. Apostle, let me give you a testimony.
With that testimony, I want you to add in my next question, because we are right at the point of the next question. I notice sometimes that you don't always have the traditional grape juice in altar bread. Is using water or another kind of food, taking the sacredness from taking the Lord's Supper?
Not at all. Because whatever it is that people get, it's a representation. It's a representation. If I don't have the juice, if I don't have the juice or whatever it is, because then I can use water and translate water into the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
I can translate this water and I say, I translate this water into the blood of Jesus Christ. Remember the authority God has given to us. Remember Adam. Whatever Adam called, whatever he called it, God confirmed it was so. Remember the naming of the things in the garden? Whatever Adam said was, it was. So when you pick up water and say, I translate this water into the blood of Jesus, I come to the table of fellowship to partake of your flesh and your blood. Lord, I come before your presence. This is your flesh. And as I partake of your flesh, it is the premise and the principle that matters, the spiritual significance, not actually the ornaments themselves.
Amen. Finally, describe as you did during the episode where you talked about the land rejecting us. How does our land reject us and turn against us?
Wow. That's beautiful, Apostle. Now, we need to look at a couple of scriptures that confirm that. I'll take you to, I'll go to, that's Leviticus chapter 20, verse 22, Amplified Version, I read. You shall therefore keep all my statutes and all my ordinances and do them, that the land where I am bringing you to dwell may not vomit you out, as it did before, as it did those before you. Then you go on to see Leviticus 18, 20 to 28. It says, moreover, you shall not lie carnally with your neighbor's wife to defile yourself with her. You shall not give any of your children to pass through the fire to sacrifice them to Molech, the fire god. Nor shall you profane the name of your God by giving it to false gods. I am the Lord. You shall not lie with a man as with a woman. It is an abomination. Neither shall you lie with any beast and defile yourself with it. Neither shall any woman yield herself to a beast to lie with it. It is confusion, perversion, and degradedly carnal. Do not defile yourselves in any of these ways, for in these things, the nations are defiled, which I am casting out before you, and the land is defiled. Therefore, I visit the iniquity of it upon it, and the land itself vomits out her inhabitants. So you shall keep my statutes and my ordinances, and shall not commit any of these abominations, neither the native born nor any stranger who sojourns among you. For all these abominations have the men of the land done before you, have the men of the land done who were before you. And the land is defiled, done of these things, lest the land spew you out when you defile it as it spewed out the nations before you. It vomited them. Apostle, people don't realize all the elements, creation, the land. The Bible says the land will yield her strength unto you. The land will yield. The Bible talks about there is nowhere in Psalms 19, there is nowhere in all creation that the language of creation is not heard. So these elements, they hear, they speak. The reason the Canaanites, Perizzites, Jebusites were ejected, they defiled the land and it vomited them. So when we say the land can reject you, your economy can reject you. When you don't prosper, the land can reject you, can vomit you out. There are many things the land can do to vomit you out. It can cause your economy to crash. Diseases can begin to multiply, as we see on here, because the land has rejected you, because you have defiled it. You have defiled it, so it will spew you out. It will refuse to favor you. You can, when you defile the land, you discover that even you can start a business and your business will not prosper. Why? there are things that cause divine judgment on the land to come against people. Some of the natural disasters that we see is because of the judgment that the land is spewing its inhabitants. It has had enough.
Amen. Apostle, we are at the end of this broadcast. We are going to have a part two with you. How can the kingdom learn more about you and your ministry?
The kingdom can learn more about me and my ministry. I'm always on, if you look out for Apostle Moses M. Kwagala, I'm on Facebook there. By the grace of God, I'm the senior pastor and founder of the Rebuilders House here in Kenya. And those who may want to know more about the ministry, they can follow us on the Rebuilders House. We have a page on my page called the Rebuilders House. We are at the moment also going through a reconstruction of our church because we lost a piece or a lease of the land that we were on before. The landlord raised a lot of money when he saw our church growing so fast. He raised the money. And after raising that money, he was asking us actually $1 million. And I told him, I don't have it and I've never held it. So because he had seen we had built on the land, he was taking advantage. So we were basically told to leave. So we lost every property we had there, almost worth maybe 500, worth around about $400,000. Of property. So we had to move where we are. We are now building, rebuilding at the moment. The church has no floor. We want to do a proper roof. We don't have a floor. Anyone who wants to stand with us, I can send you the details, which is PayPal, Moses M. Kwagala at Gmail, my PayPal details. They can stand with us. We really need partners to allow me to do what God has called me to do because, Apostle, it's good that you've spoken to me because I would love to come and establish altars in each and every state. We are praying for the United States with passion because it is part of the end time plan of God. And I am mandated to raise altars of intercessors. We come. I don't ask for money, really. I'm not a person who's, I don't expect you to pay bills. This, I don't fly big hotels or whatever. But my mandate is to establish an altar where there is an intercessor. We come and do meetings, revival and healing meetings, because God has anointed me with the grace to as we speak, my PA, the one you see following me on TAC, the one who helps me, she died in January 2017. That's when she died. And we put her in the church and we shut the church. And we prayed for 5 hours and 42 minutes, and the Lord brought her back to life. That's my PA, the one you see, Shekinah Wema. So the Lord has done many wonderful miracles, but the Lord wants me to pass on my mantle to the nations and raise intercessors in each and every city with an altar in us for us to be able to take over those nations. I cannot do this work by myself. I need partners who may want to partner with this ministry. And also, first and foremost, to establish the best for us, what we need now is a roof on top of that church. That's all I can say, Apostle.
Amen. Kingdom, Let's Talk to the Lord can be heard on iHeartRadio, Speaker.com, Spotify, Alexa.TuneIn Radio, Facebook, and YouTube. My latest EP, Remember Now Thy Creator, is available in all digital stores and have been nominated for 5 Rhythm of the Gospel Awards. We've been nominated in Categories 21, Urban Contemporary Song of the Year, Category 22, Holy Hip Hop and R&B Song of the Year, Category 24, Alternative Christian Song of the Year, Category 39, Traditional Male Vocalist of the Year, and Category 56, Best Performance by a Male. Voting has begun. To support me, vote for me at www.therhythmofgospelawards.com and cast your vote for me, please, in each and every category. Finally, our prayer lives are one of the key principles to relationship with God through Jesus Christ. The scripture declares that the effectual, fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Lord, help us to pray with confidence that you hear us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jesus.
You are my hiding place. You come and fill my heart with songs of deliverance whenever I'm afraid. I will trust in you.
I don't have to be afraid because you're with me and you'll never leave me.
I will trust in you. Thank you for your mercy. Lord, I thank you for your love that's made a way to come into your presence and magnify your name. Lord, I stand amazed by what I see. Great is your mercy toward me, your loving kindness toward me, your tender mercies I see day after day.
El Shaddai. Oh, Jesus, I love you, I love you.